there, and welcome to PhD at Living. Today we're talking glues, and that particular rabbit hole goes as far as you'd think it would. Let me say that while a not insignificant portion of my job entails ensuring adhesion in one specific kind of system, the chemistry and physics here are intense. I am by no means an expert, but can speak just dangerously enough to say something that's probably stupid. Adhesion chemists of the world, I humbly proffer this video for your scorn. Being that the adhesives world is too large for a person to even begin to cover in a single video, today we're going to stay domestic and talk about glues that you would find around your house. The general gist for these adhesives is as follows. They start as a liquid, whether as a material dissolved in a solvent that then evaporates and creates a solid-like substance, or as a liquid or liquids that chemically react to make a solid. Either way, the conversion of the liquid into a solid while in contact with the things you're trying to adhere is what makes an adhesive, well, an adhesive. But how does all that work chemically? Well, as you well know, I have young kids, so predictably, let's talk about kids' glue. Your standard white kids' glue from the company with the cow on the label is made of polyvinyl acetate, this molecule shown here. It's a polymer of the monomer vinyl acetate, double bond here, blow that open and brrr, polymerize away, and the standard number of vinyl acetate units in the polyvinyl acetate in the glue is usually about 500 to 1500 units or so. I am also just flattered for those of you who noticed, I did get a new whiteboard. It's actually made of glass this time instead of 8x4 melamine panels I've bought from Lowe's for the last 3 years. Also, it's a huge pain to light. I have both my softboxes without their diffusers on just blasting light from over here and one from high above. I also have a lamp without a shade on it that just has a single bulb burning into my eyeballs like Anthony Hopkins' first look at John Hurt in Elephant Man. While it doesn't make the strongest bond of all time, PVAC, not to be confused with PVA, polyvinyl alcohol, is about the perfect thing for kids to use and is as safe and harmless as it gets. The glue itself is almost certainly just a binary composition of the PVAC and water, and the glue hardens by the water evaporating or soaking into the thing you're applying it to, let's say, for instance, popsicle sticks. Polyvinyl acetate is completely safe to handle with bare hands, so no gloves, has no harmful fumes of which to speak, and is even non-toxic if you eat it. So, about as harmless as a glue gets. Polyvinyl acetate is non-toxic almost certainly because it's hydrolyzed into acetic acid and polyvinyl alcohol, our true PVA. Acetic acid is just concentrated vinegar, so no harm in this one as long as it's not super concentrated, and PVA has very poor absorption in the body and is almost certainly non-toxic even if it didn't. Rats have been given, and I know animal studies don't equal human studies, I've said it before on this channel, anyway, rats have been given up to 5 grams per kilogram a day of PVA with no observed adverse effects. That's the equivalent of you eating like a king-size Snickers bar of pure PVA. Yes, all 3 servings. Who's gonna eat a single serving of a candy bar? Incidentally, this is also the glue that makes slime with borax. The borax probably hydrolyzes that acetate ester, similar to what would happen in the body, but then the free oxygen from the PVA ends up getting cross-linked with the borax and making your slime. Moving on to wood glue, we have, well, basically a spoiler alert. Wood glue is just polyvinyl acetate again, but with a cool tan tint to make it look like wood. It also usually is a bit more stable against moisture for outdoor use. Sorry that one wasn't any more exciting. Next, we get to the famous glue with the primate on the front. Turns out the flagship glue from that company is polyurethane-based, which conveniently is a type of chemistry we haven't discussed yet. A urethane linkage is typically made between the reaction of a hydroxyl group, this OH here, and an isocyanate group, the NCO functionality there. Put those together and you get a urethane linkage, that is this OC double bond ON part there. Combine a bunch of urethanes and you get, you guessed it, a polyurethane. Polyurethanes are ubiquitous. The foam in your couch, cushion, and mattress? Probably polyurethane. The plastic in your car, your computer, your house, everywhere? Also probably polyurethane. Skateboard wheels, surfboards, bowling alley lanes, spaceship fuel? You name it, polyurethanes can do it. Anywho, per the SDS for the glue online, this polyurethane is composed of polyisocyanate prepolymer based on MDI to be reacted with polymeric diphenylmethane diisocyanate, PMDI, 4,4' diphenylmethane diisocyanate, and diphenylmethane diisocyanate mixed isomers. Looking at the chemical abstract service or CAS number for each of these unique molecules can shed some light on the topic. Even still, this prepolymer is a mess. MDI is diphenylmethane diisocyanate, this molecule shown here. I'm technically showing the 4,4' isomer, although there are 2 other common isomers in industry, the 2,2' and the 2,4', or over here, doesn't matter. Functionally, they are all difunctional isocyanates, so in order for them to be polyfunctional isocyanates, they need at least one more of these NCO groups. You can get that by reacting two or more of these MDIs with something like a glycol or a polyether or anything else. The possibilities are practically endless, so it's hard to say exactly what proprietary molecule the Great Ape Glue Company is using here. Looking at the cast number from the SDS online, here's what you get. Isocyanic acid, polymethylene, polyphenylene ester, polymer with 1,2-ethane diamine, 2-methyloxyrane, and 1,2-propane diol. Huh? That unhelpful verbal description also comes with the equally unhelpful structures, shown here, not connected to anything. On its face, looking at these guys, you could react them with each other. As we'll see in a little bit, amines react with epoxides just fine, amines love isocyanates, isocyanates react with hydroxyls readily, as we saw in our urethane linkage not too far ago, and isocyanates can react with epoxides. So taking these four disparate molecules and making some kind of polymeric monster is certainly plausible, but there's just one problem. Where's the MDI? In the interest of time and not boring you to death, we'll just say that the prepolymer has a pile of isocyanates with which to react. In the shown SDS, all the other molecules are isocyanates as well, so we really just have a pile of isocyanates without too much else to make urethane linkages. So what gives? Well, this is where player C enters the game. While this molecule typically poisons polyurethane reactions, it can be used to initiate a similar one. What's that? Oh my gosh! It's Water's music! Moisture-initiated polyurethane reactions are a large branch of the adhesives industry, and their reaction proceeds like this. Step 1, our oxygen of the water nucleophilically attacks the carbon of the isocyanate group. After all, there's significant partial positive charge here from the electronegativity being pulled by the oxygen and the nitrogen of the isocyanate group. The carbon donates some electrons back to the nitrogen, leaving us this intermediate here with a negatively charged nitrogen and a positively charged oxygen. The nitrogen comes over and plucks off one of these hydrogens from the oxygen, leaving us this neutral, albeit not just complete, molecule here. The nitrogen comes over, snags another hydrogen off of that oxygen. The oxygen is going to donate back to the carbon. The carbon's going to donate back to the nitrogen, breaking this single bond completely and leaving us with a primary amine and carbon dioxide. This is a very common foaming reaction that we get in polyurethane foams, that is, water reacting with an isocyanate to alleviate carbon dioxide gas that creates the foam. We're not done yet, though. Next, the nitrogen from the created primary amine does essentially the same thing as the water oxygen did in the last reaction. That is, it reacts with a second isocyanate group, stepping through basically the same reaction mechanism to give us our final polyure... Well, that's not actually a polyurethane. That's a polyurea. Huh. With the elimination of carbon dioxide in the moisture isocyanate reaction and the subsequent primary amine additional isocyanate yielding this product up here, calling a moisture-cured polyisocyanate a polyurethane is technically a misnomer, which means calling a glue using this reaction mechanism a polyurethane glue is also not technically correct, which is the best kind. But this is where it gets truly messy. If the polymeric MDI also has some free hydroxyls, say in a reaction with a glycol, then we could have a true polyurethane adhesive. If, however, it only has the polyisocyanates, then we're dealing with a moisture-cured polyurea. But Devin, does it even make a lick of difference? Generally, I would say not much, but specifically here, the difference between a polyurethane and a polyurea is actually quite large. Can you see it? Well, yeah. The polyurea got two nitrogens on either side of the carbonyl, and the polyurethane has one nitrogen and one oxygen. Well, yeah, but can you see why that's such a big difference? It's not just the electronegativity difference here. The nitrogen can make an extra bond than the oxygen can, and that extra bond is an NH bond. And what do we know about NH bonds? Hydrogen bond? Hydrogen bonding! The increased prevalence of hydrogen bonding in polyureas increases intermolecular interactions. What that means is for a given pair of R and R prime substituents, the polyurea version of that molecule tends to be stiffer than its polyurethane cousin. So it's not just semantics, people! In summary, the difference between a true polyurethane adhesive and a polyisocyanate-only moisture-cured polyurea can be tricky to see, especially if you don't know the exact chemicals in that glue. At any rate, those reactions lead to materials that have almost identical bonding and almost equivalent strength and stiffness. After beating that one to death, what about glue guns? you know, the solid cylinder is a polymer that become liquid when you force them through the hot tip of the squeezy gun thing and then burn the hell out of your hands when you get it on you. What are those made of? First principles would tell us that these glues are thermoplastic, meaning elevated temperature puts us through a simple physical phase change from solid to liquid, and then as the liquid cools back down into a solid, that's what gives you your glue. This stands in contrast to many polyurethanes, which are thermosetting polymers. Thermosetting here meaning the elevated temperature gives us an irreversible chemical change to get our polymer. These thermosetting polymers are then solids at all temperatures up to where they decompose. The thermoplastic polymer also stands in contrast to the solvent-based glues we talked about, which are only liquids in the first place because they have a volatile solvent that evaporates away, leaving you with your solid glue. Okay, so what polymers have thermoplastic properties like that? Well, it turns out there are three main ones: ethyl vinyl acetate, amorphous polyalpha olefins, and polyamides. Going to the SDSs doesn't help us here again because these materials are widely regarded as non-toxic. Ethylene vinyl acetate, or EVA, is a copolymer of ethylene, wouldn't you know it, and vinyl acetate, the base for our polyvinyl acetate kids glue from earlier. How about that? Amorphous polyalpha olefins are harder to nail down but are essentially polymers of olefins, fancy word for alkenes, where the double bond is in the 1 or alpha position. Think of something like 1-propene, 1-butene, etc. The reason these polymers are amorphous is because when you blow open that polymer chain, the arrangement of the chiral substituents is random or atactic. So what we're looking at here, when you blow open these double bonds, make your polymer chain, these substituents are going to be different, which introduces chirality into your polymer. When the arrangement of that chirality is random or atactic, it gives you your amorphous character. Compare this to something like polyethylene, where we start from ethene. When this polymer chain is made, all of the hydrogens are equivalent, which means you have symmetry, which means you don't have chirality, which means you tend to have more crystalline character than amorphous character, but we're getting way off the road right now. Finally, we have polyamides, such as nylon. For an example, let's show nylon-6,6, this molecule here. Similar to polyureas, the nitrogen functionality in polyamides leads to increased hydrogen bonding, which means nylons tend to be stiffer than comparable polymers with other functional groups. Next, we get to a glue with a mental problem. An insane adhesive, if you will. These types of glues typically use cyanoacrylates, and like isocyanate-based adhesives, are cured using moisture. The main ingredient in superglue is usually ethyl cyanoacrylate, this molecule shown here. Ethyl-2-cyanoprobe-2-eno-8 for those of you IU Packers at home. The reaction with water proceeds as follows. Step 1. The oxygen in the water nucleophilically attacks this carbon here, and electrons are donated back to this middle carbon here, leading to this. What? A carbon with a lone pair and a negative charge? Well, I'll be. That's called a carbanion, and while they're not very common, we have one here. If it makes you feel any better, there is some resonance stability through the carbonyl down here and the nitrile up here, so it's not super duper crazy unstable. It is still unstable though and wants to find a fourth bond for that carbon, so we start what's called a nucleophilic chain polymerization reaction, wherein this intermediate attacks another ethyl cyanoacrylate molecule, creating another carbanion, and we get our polymer. Science! Cyanoacrylates can also patch holes in stuff, such as my camping mattress, which PH Dog at Living poked a hole in with his sharp nails. They can also patch holes in humans. You ever see that Dermabond stuff? Yeah, it's just octyl cyanoacrylate. The octyl functionality makes the material less mobile and therefore less toxic than the methyl or ethyl versions, which is good, you know, when you're repairing a hole in a human that isn't supposed to be there. Next, we have rubber cement, which is pretty similar to wood glue. It's a fairly boring mixture of some rubber compound and a volatile solvent. Solvent evaporates away, your rubber compound is left, you got your glue. The solvent in one rubber cement I have at home is Legroin, which is sort of just petroleum ether, which itself is just a messy mixture of a bunch of small chain aliphatic hydrocarbons. It's great because PET ether evaporates very quickly, but it's also extremely flammable, so watch out for those fires while using rubber cement. The working material in a different one I saw was terpenylene, this molecule here. And that's about it, right? We don't really... Yeah, move on. Okay, let's move on. Next, we get to the trusted epoxy adhesive. Again, something of a misnomer, epoxies are actually based on epoxide chemistry, epoxide being a three-membered ring with two carbons and one oxygen. Epoxies are almost always a two-part combination of a material with an epoxide functionality and another material with an amine functionality, the substituent groups determining the final cured properties. My reaction mechanism, and I'm sure I'm a broken record here, is nucleophilic attack of the amine nitrogen on the epoxide carbon, donates electrons back to the oxygen, breaks that bond completely. The oxygen then comes and snags a hydrogen off the now positively charged nitrogen. You play ring around the electron, Rosie, and we end up with this final reaction product for our epoxy. Unlike a lot of other adhesive systems, epoxy reactions are very exothermic and can even thermally run away if too much material is mixed and allowed to locally self-heat. The reason for this is twofold. Number one, there's a lot of ring strain energy in this three-membered epoxide ring, so energy is released when it's opened up, and the reaction with an amine is extremely fast. Amines tend to react with isocyanates very quickly too, but there's no ring strain being opened up in the isocyanates, so you don't get that increased energy, and epoxides can react with isocyanates, thereby giving you your ring opening strain energy, but it doesn't happen as fast as with the amine. So it is a combination of both the speed and the energy of the reaction that can lead to epoxies running away where other reaction mechanisms won't. Before we get to the next section, huge shout out to Brent from Goobertown Hobbies, who in addition to having amazing hair is a legit PhD chemist brethren of mine and explains the reaction chemistry of epoxies and cyanoacrylates in beautiful detail. Kudos to him, and I will post links in the description. Finally, let's talk about silicones. This is a completely different type of chemistry. I've said that like three times now, haven't I? Anyway, silicones deal with the element silicon. The general idea is there's a monomer that reacts to create a polymer and something is relieved in the process. Let's take, for instance, ethyl triacetoxysilane. When hydrolyzed during moisture cure, boy, that sounds familiar, we end up with a trifunctional silanol and three molecules of acetic acid evolved. Then you can take a number of these trifunctional silanol molecules, do a condensation reaction relieving water, and get the repeating SiO-SiO siloxane functionality in an overall polymeric molecule called a silicone. If you don't want that acidic smell, simply react with a neutral silane, such as an ether or an oxime. If for some reason you want a fishy smell, you can react with an aminosilane. Any of the bunch, the same mechanism as before applies, giving you a repeating siloxane polymer that can be used for your adhesive, or what most silicones are used for, as a sealant. Alright, that was a not-so-quick discussion of the relevant chemistries of a variety of different glues, but that's not the real meat and potatoes of adhesion. No, for that, we're going to have to blend chemistry and physics to really get at why things are sticky in the first place. But that's for then, and this is for now. See y'all next time. Give me the stick 'em. Coach, ain't that stuff illegal? What are they going to do, put you in football jail?